Don't let anybody make you think that God chose America as his divine messianic force to be a sort of policeman of the whole world. God has a way of standing before the nations with judgment, and it seems that I can hear God saying to America, you're too arrogant. And if you don't change your ways, I will rise up and break the backbone of your power.
Otep, this is Femi, here with Freedom Now, and your ears are in tuned at high frequencies in a liberated zone. Freedom Now is a Pan-Africanist, global news outlet from coast to coast, dispelling the Western propaganda media and their all lies point of views. Freedom Now is devoted to relay true news, views, and proper clues to form solutions around freedom for the oppressed worldwide. Now, get relaxed, grab a pen, and phone a friend, because Freedom Now is set to begin to awaken deep sleepers dreaming about freedom now within in Freedom Now in.
This is Sister Thage with Freedom Now's agenda for this Saturday, July 1st, 2023. Our central theme is Black Women, Creativity and Defamation. We commence with our sister Luyanda Kaboka and the African Drumbeat Historical Calendar. Then, this hour, prolific author, radical historian, professor of African American Studies at the University of Houston, and Freedom Now co-producer, Dr. Gerald Horne interviews Dr. Moya Bailey, Associate Professor in the Department of Communication Studies at Northwestern University and author of the book Misogynoir Transformed, Black Women's Digital Resistance. And later in the hour, Dr. Horne interviews Dr. Melanie Herzog, Professor Emerita of Art History at Edward College in Wisconsin and author of the book Elizabeth Catlett, an American Artist in Mexico. Also this hour, our prison radio commentaries are from Mumia Abu-Jamal on Death Row Then and Now, from Crystal Clark, she's imprisoned at Huron Valley Women's Prison in Pittsfield Township in Michigan, and she discusses what about our lives. And also, finally, we'll hear a prison radio commentary from Bilal Muhammad on fighting starvation and malnourishment. Our music clip mix includes MLK, Zap Mama, Lonnie Liston Smith, Pharoah Sanders, Horace Silver, Eric Dolphy, Benny Golson. So sit back, phone a friend, and as always, we stand ready for revolution.
Molweni Ekaya, this is Sister Luyanda Kaboka with Freedom Now's weekly African Drumbeat historical calendar with significant dates and events that reflect the struggle of the oppressed for the week of July 4th. July 4th, 1930. The Nation of Islam was founded by Master Fard Muhammad. The nation continues in the tradition of African nationalist religious movements which seek to spiritually and politically better the conditions of African prisoners of the European slavetocracies and wars on Africa. The Nation of Islam has produced great leaders such as Minister Malcolm X, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and Minister Louis Farrakhan, and more importantly has transformed thousands of men from predators of the community to soldiers in the struggle of righteousness against Western decadence. July 5th, 1962. Algeria gains independence after an 8-year guerrilla war where over 1 million Africans gave their lives against French colonialism. Ahmed Ben Bella and Frantz Fanon are two among many whose spirit and ideological skills became role models for the continued liberation movements that occurred, best immortalized in the film Battle of Algiers, where the twin evils of colonialism and neocolonialism are exposed. July 6th, late 19th century, Sarah Noir, warrior queen of the Asnas, who in early 1899, through brilliant tactical maneuvering and the creative promulgation of her reputation as a witch demoness, successfully defended her African kingdom from the advancing forces of French capitalism. July 7, 1954. TANU, the Tanganyika African National Union, which was the movement of national liberation of the microstate of Tanzania, begins the mass protest confrontation stage of struggle against British colonialism through countrywide strikes and boycotts. July 7, 1975. Melba Hernandez, a Cuban guerrilla and a member of the July 26 movement with Fidel Castro, helps launch the Cuban Revolution. Melba was a founding member of the Cuban Communist Party and was brutally tortured by the Batista neocolonial government. July 9, 1972. More than 3,000 Chicano workers, 85% of whom were Chicana women, went on strike against the Farah Pants Company in El Paso, Texas. They walked out demanding a union. July 10, 1875. Mary McLeod Bethune was born in Maysville, South Carolina, one of 17 children of Samuel and Patsy McLeod, former slaves. Mary worked in the cotton fields with her family. She founded the Daytona Normal and Industrial Institute for Negro Girls, now known as Bethune-Cookman College, in 1904. And she served as president from 1904 to 1942 and from 1946 to 1947. She was a leader in the Black Women's Club movement and served as president of the National Association of Colored Women. She was one of the founders of National Council of Negro Women, vice president of the NAACP, was awarded the Haitian Medal of Honor and Merit, that country's highest award, and in Liberia, she received the honor of Commander of the Order of the Star of Africa. This has been Sister Luyanda Koboka with Freedom Now, 90.7 FM in Southern California and 98.7 FM in Santa Barbara. Streaming live on www.kpfk.org. If you have any questions or comments, email us at freedomnow@kpfk.org. And in the language of resistance in South Africa, as the listening audience, join us in our chant for freedom. Amandla, awetu! Amandla, awetu! Amandla, awetu!
Death row, then and now. It is a daunting task to describe death row, that peculiarly American institution of ultimate exclusion, where men, women were sent to rot, to sit, to die. In the beginning, guys spent 23 and 1, meaning 23 hours in a cell, and 1 hour out. After some minor protests and hunger strikes, the regime became 22 hours in a cell and 2 hours outside. That endured for years. And then a United Nations expert, Juan Mendez, the body's special rapporteur on torture, issued an official opinion declaring that any amount of time passed 13 days in solitary confinement constituted irreparable damage to the psyche and thus violated international law. Armed with such research, the Abolitionist Law Center of Pittsburgh contacted the state's prison administrators to challenge the lockdown of death row after months of haggling and negotiations. A new reality dawned on death row. Men spent over 6 hours a day out of cell, had contact visits with family and friends, and intermingled with other guys in population. They went to the yards with other men. To many men who spent decades on death row, this new thing became unrecognizable. More importantly, some men gained new trials, and several went home. Over the years, you've no doubt heard me speak of many of them and their walk away from the house of darkness. Quietly, dozens of other cases endured resentencing, so that some received time served and others lesser sentences. And yet, death row remains a weapon. It therefore needs far more than reform. It needs to be abolished. With love, not fear. This is Mumia Abu-Jamal. These commentaries are recorded by Prison Radio.
From Pacifica Radio, KPFK Los Angeles, Freedom Now, this is Gerald Horne. And with me on the line is Professor Moya Bailey, Associate Professor of Communication Studies at Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois, and author of the book, Misogynoir Transformed, Black Women's Digital Resistance. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK Los Angeles, Professor Bailey.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure.
And it's a pleasure to have you. So why did you write this book?
So the short answer is that is something that is required of my field. I'm a book field, so that's the short answer. The longer answer is I really wanted to explore the way that Black women were resisting some of the ways that they were being depicted in popular media, particularly on social media platforms. And writing this book was an opportunity to look at that resistance very closely. And misogynoir is a term that I coined that describes the particular anti-Black racist misogyny that Black women experience. And so this book was an opportunity for me to really highlight the resistance that Black women were able to create for themselves in the very same platforms that were often used as vehicles to denigrate them in the first place.
So what is an example of the kind of defamation that you're referring to? And what is an example of the more adroit resistance to that very same defamation?
Sure. So one of the examples that I explore in the book is looking at how Black trans women specifically have been targeted by misogynoir in terms of how they're depicted in popular culture and media. And for example, you might see representations of Black trans women that show them as ugly, as men trying to be women, etc. So all of these representations are designed to make Black trans women seem sort of ridiculous and not real. And one of the ways that trans women have tried to combat this representation is through creating their own media platforms and campaigns. So Janet Mock created the hashtag Girls Like Us, which was really a way to signal to other trans women that there is space for them in our digital platforms. So Janet Mock's hashtag Girls Like Us was mobilized to create opportunities for Black trans women on Twitter to find each other. And ultimately, other trans women started to use the hashtag as well to talk about just generic things, you know, what's going on in their lives, the mundane. And because it was on a public platform like Twitter, it allowed for other people to gaze in, to look in on the conversation that was happening and the conversation that was being marked by this particular hashtag. And so that really created an opportunity for people to counter some of the negative ways that they were being represented, also by not actively having to direct response to some of these negative representations. People were just using the hashtag to talk about what was going on in their day-to-day lives. And that sort of transformational digital alchemy is something that I talk about in the book, this idea that people are creating what they want to see and not necessarily always reacting to some of the negative images and negative representations that exist.
So who is Megan Thee Stallion, and how does her experience illustrate the theme of your book?
So Megan Thee Stallion is a pretty famous Black rapper who is, in the last, I'd say the last couple of years, has gotten a lot of attention for her rhyming capability. But you might have heard about a trial that she was involved in when she was allegedly, although now I believe the court has said she was, which she said, shot by a fellow rapper named Tory Lanez. And what happened after this was she did not want to go to the police, but because there was a shooting and there was evidence that she had been shot, she was asked to testify in a trial of Tory Lanez for this shooting. And she was denigrated in the process. So even though she was the one who was shot, the public backlash against her and outcry against her for even testifying was really severe. And there were lots of talk. There was lots of talk of Megan as somehow denigrating the Black community, doing something against Black men for actually speaking up about what happened to her. And again, I want to mention that she did this under a bit of duress and even tried to avoid talking to the police initially, because I think she, like many of us in our community, is very concerned with the way that Black men are unjustly and often connected to our carceral system. And I don't think she wanted that for Tory Lanez, but she was pulled into the trial and had to testify. And what's interesting is that there was a way that people started to think of it as a trial against Megan, as opposed to looking at it as a trial of Tory Lanez for his shooting of Megan.
Now, there are likely those in our audience who are familiar with that case since it unfolded in Los Angeles itself. And speaking of popular culture, what is Swarm and how does it illustrate the theme of your book?
So Swarm is a new series that I believe was on Prime. And Swarm is a show that features Dominique Fishback, and actor portraying a character who has an unhealthy obsession with a figure who in this, you know, generated world is akin to our Beyoncé. And in the series, Dominique's character is seen killing people who don't love Beyoncé as much as she does. And what's interesting to me in terms of how Misogynoir operates in this particular series is that, excuse me, Dominique is trying to, I don't know, manage a deep-seated sense of abandonment through her love of Beyoncé. And while that is an okay depiction for anyone, what ends up happening in the series is that Dominique is portrayed as somebody who doesn't really have any social, I would say, any social or moral compass because of this overriding love for this star. And the portrayal of Black women in that is the loss of her humanity and the loss of other people's humanity for not loving Beyoncé, this Beyoncé figure in this world. So the way that Misogynoir comes through is in this portrayal of this woman as completely devoid of anything but adoration for this Beyoncé character.
Mm-hmm. Now, are there platforms that are better or worse with regard to defaming Black women? For example, Twitter, YouTube, Tumblr, Reddit, or are there platforms that best illustrate resistance to defamation of Black women?
Yeah, you know, I think Twitter started out as a platform that offered a lot of space for people to create a representation that countered some of the negative representations that were happening on the same platform. So as I mentioned, the hashtag Girls Like Us was something created by community to counter some of those negative representations. But as Twitter has shifted with Elon Musk's purchase of the platform, it's harder for people to use it in the generative ways that they used it before. I've seen a lot of activists and organizers moving to other platforms because of how Twitter has changed in just the last couple of months. One thing I will say is that Facebook has been proven to use algorithms that promote a certain level of visibility to content that reinforces certain stereotypes that people already hold. So, for example, if you're somebody who is already a fan of Donald Trump, the algorithm of Facebook is going to move in such a way that you're going to see ads and content that affirm your beliefs and don't necessarily disprove them. So I think Facebook is a platform that's much more difficult to generate the kind of resistance that could shift someone's perspective on the way Black women are represented in pop culture generally.
Mm-hmm. Now, who is Lena Waithe? And how does her work illustrate themes of your book?
Lena Waithe is an actor, producer, director, writer who has created a lot of different popular media. She is a Black lesbian and got a lot of positive attention for a wonderful episode of the show Master of None, talking about a coming out story of a Black lesbian that she portrayed on the show. And Angela Bassett played her mother in that particular episode. And I think it's really one of the most beautiful examples of undoing misogynoir in terms of how Black queer people are generally represented in popular culture. But in terms of my book, I talk about how Lena Waithe got her start. And something people might not know is that she wrote a web series of videos around the time that different creators were using YouTube to do videos about the things that certain people say. So she was part of a series called Things Black Girls Say. Also, that word is not things. But as the writer of this particular series, she really harnessed a lot of stereotypes about Black women in that particular series. And it went viral, ending up with something like a million or more views. And a lot of those, to me, represent some of the caricatures that we have seen of Black women throughout time. So in the book, I talk about this particular strategy of using some of these traditional caricatures of Black women to mobilize them towards a career, because there's some ease in which if you denigrate Black women, you can actually move up in the entertainment industry. And so I see her work now as somehow countering or trying to counter some of those early representations that she was responsible for bringing to the small screen or to YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Finally, Professor Bailey, author of the book Misogynoir, Transformed Black Women's Digital Resistance. You're at Northwestern University in Illinois. Would you recommend to those who would like to be the next Professor Bailey to come there for graduate study?
Yes, I absolutely would. I think that Northwestern has a wonderful cadre of faculty who are ready to greet students in a number of areas that would prepare them for a really wonderful career within academia, whether that's through the program I'm connected to, the Department of Communication, or other departments within the School of Communication. I do think that there's a lot of opportunity for graduate students within this field and at Northwestern specifically.
Well, I'm afraid we're going to have to leave it there, Professor Bailey. Thank you for joining us on KPFK Pacifica Freedom Now, Los Angeles.
Thanks for having me.
Hi, my name is Crystal Denise Clark. My MA number is 435-064. I'm in WHV, the Valley of Death. They are killing us in here. They're trying to turn us against each other. You know, is this the doctors in here, these ladies in here that's pregnant, they are getting sick. The mold is affecting them. They are getting sick. Guess as well as the Dr. Ellis is playing with my life. He won't tell me my results. Some of my results is not, you know, good. The nurse had told me, but he won't go over them with me. This is a shame. Bear with me, the world. He took my heart medicine and didn't renew it for like over a month. My blood pressure has been high. I'm still swollen up. The stuff still is crusty all in my ears, leaking. Like the ladies in the infirmary, I just heard one of them is over there. Like, we don't know if she's going to make it or not. It's only, I just want to know, like, for the attorneys, like, y'all don't want to take prisoner cases, a lot of y'all don't. But when we die, y'all first to call our family. Don't let it wait to that time. We need help right now. Like, please help us. Like, the water is like the drinking fountain. It's gray. It stink. We're drinking out one fountain because we don't really have clean and fresh water. We can't stay in the shower for even like 5 or 10 minutes because it's breaking us out and we itching so bad. Like, this is wrong. The food that we eat is so disgusting. They run out of food and strap up food to send us. Like, throw it everywhere. That is E. coli. Like, you can catch all kinds of bacteria from this food. I'm so tired, and I try to stay strong, but it's killing me. I'm tired. And then we got to deal with some of the officers. You know, we got some good ones, but we got some bad ones. Treat us like nothing. Come in here and just terrorize us and torture us for no reason. Like, this is not cool. This is unstoppable. I've been wanting to talk to y'all. This is unstoppable. Healthcare, death care, they need to go down. This prison need to go down. Just like that other prison that they did, we need this prison right here to be investigated because this is wrong. County, Washington, all of them know about it. And then you got inmates in here trying to harass you, force you to go look up your cases and talk about you. Y'all supposed to be, we're supposed to stick together. But the officers got them doing this. This is unstoppable, y'all. They are torturing us in here. Like, we need help. Like, if anybody hearing us listen to us, and I know y'all do, I love y'all, man, we need help before it's too late. And I'm speaking for all us, because it's not me. We need help. Dr. Ellis, all of them, Dr. Ellis, Hunt, Director Jones, Hump Tinsley, they nurses, every time I go over there, I'm getting treated so bad. Like, everybody get treated, like, some of them, you know, they treat them nice. Then me, I come over there, like, the cameras, speakers prove everything. Why, Miss Washington, she for us, she say, Washington can't come in here and talk to a couple of us and pull us out, and then we could give her the times and dates so she can see that it's, we telling the truth. She don't want to do that because I feel like she's in on it. It's all about money for them. Like, the warden, he ought to be ashamed of himself. Like, he need to stay in here for a couple of days and see how he got. He probably can't even do the fine. Like, this is wrong. Like, a lot of us in here, we should not even be here. But we didn't get a sentence to die. They're killing us. Please help us. All our body getting all kinds of white spots. We're getting moles everywhere. Rashes just coming up our body. Like, this is unstoppable. Red spots, and they just telling us there ain't nothing wrong. And covering up my health and covering up our medical? Please help us. A lot of y'all, I haven't been getting letters, so if y'all been writing me, they probably been, you know, taking our mail, playing with our mail, but we need some support. Jay, pay us or something. Let us know that y'all hear us. We love y'all and thank y'all so much. It's a lot of stuff that I, it's a lot, but I will be calling y'all back soon. Love y'all so much and thank you.
These commentaries are recorded by Prison Radio.
This is Sister Flora, and you are listening to Freedom Now at KPFK 90.7 FM in occupied Mexico, including Los Angeles, 98.7 FM Santa Barbara, 93.7 FM in San Diego, and streaming live on the web at kpfk.org. Today's program, as well as 10 prior editions, can be reheard at kpfk.org/audio archive, and scroll down to Freedom Now. From 12 to 1 p.m., following Freedom Now, is her sister Asunta, with Spotlight Africa addressing issues facing Mother Africa. For a truly alternative international perspective on world affairs, check out RTTV Russia, CCTV China, and online at Presna, Latina Cuba, Telesur, Venezuela. News 24, South Africa, and Press TV, Iran. We will now continue with historian Professor Dr. Gerald Horne.
From KPFK Los Angeles, this is Gerald Horne for Freedom Now, and with me on the line is Melanie Herzog, Professor Emerita of Art History at Edgewood College in Wisconsin, and author of Elizabeth Catlett, An American Artist in Mexico. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK Los Angeles, Professor Herzog.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's really an honor to be on your show.
Well, it's an honor to have you. So who was Elizabeth Catlett and why did you decide to write about her?
Elizabeth Catlett was an amazing, fabulous artist, and I think one of the most important artists of the 20th and early 21st centuries, somebody who I hope your listeners will be curious to learn more about. I decided to write about her because I fell in love with her art, and I deeply respected her commitment to social justice, her commitment to liberation, her commitment to freedom, an appropriate topic for your show, and the way in which she manifested those commitments in her art over the course of multiple decades, working both in the United States and in Mexico. And I was particularly interested in her work in Mexico because while certainly it had been talked about, when I started learning about her, she was really talked about primarily as an African-American artist, which of course she was. And that's super important. She was a proud Black nationalist, and she described herself as, she would say, I am a Black woman artist, and that was important to her. And Mexico was also so important to her. But that idea of working across borders, of transnational solidarity, wasn't talked about quite as much. And that was something that I was super curious about.
So how did she learn how to sculpt?
Elizabeth Catlett actually, as a child, learned how to sculpt. She was really fascinated with art making, and her parents, her mother, who believed very strongly in education, her father passed not long before she was born. He had actually taught at Tuskegee, and her mother was very committed to the education of her children. And so she supported young Elizabeth in learning different kinds of art. But she really learned how to sculpt when she was a student. She studied at Howard University, and then several years after graduating, went to the University of Iowa, and she studied sculpture there. She actually earned the first Master of Fine Arts degree in sculpture that was awarded at the University of Iowa, and perhaps the first in the United States. Although I always say perhaps because I keep thinking someone will correct me if I say it's the first one, but word on the street is that it may have been the first one. So she learned from looking at a lot of examples of sculpture. She learned from her professors, both at Howard and at the University of Iowa. She also continued her studies of sculpture with Osip Zadkine, who had come from Europe. He was fleeing the advance of the Nazis in Europe and went to New York. So she worked with him, and she said that she credited him with teaching her about the importance of abstraction and really taught her how to work as a sculptor using the visual language of abstraction, which she said, after all, was born in Africa. So she felt like it was quite legitimate for her to do that. And she also studied sculpture as well in Mexico before she began teaching sculpture there.
Why and when did she move to Mexico, and where in Mexico did she reside?
Elizabeth Catlett first went to Mexico in 1946. She had a Rosenwald grant, and she very much wanted to learn more about the art that was being made in Mexico, the prints and the sculpture, and also the murals, of course, that were being painted in the aftermath of the Mexican Revolution. She was interested in these manifestations of a people's art, art that would speak to and for the people of Mexico. So she wrote herself a Rosenwald Fund grant, and when it was renewed for the second year, she went to Mexico. She said some people were going to Paris, but she couldn't afford that, so off she went to Mexico. And her plan was to spend just a few months there. It was to spend longer than a few months, maybe a year. And she wanted to meet the artists at the Taller de Gráfico Popular, the renowned people's printmaking workshop. She wanted to make prints there. She wanted to study sculpture. She wanted to meet the muralists. She came back to the United States after a few months to end her marriage to the artist Charles White, well known, of course, in Los Angeles and beyond. And then she went back to Mexico in 1947 to make her home there. So she was initially in Mexico City. That's where the Taller de Gráfico Popular is. That's where she studied sculpture. That's where she took up residence. And then it was much later, in 1975, after her retirement from teaching, that she moved to Cuernavaca in Mexico.
So you mentioned Los Angeles, and you mentioned the well-known Black artist Charles White. I understand that she was also a comrade of Samela Lewis, another Black Angelina. Talk to us about that.
Samela Lewis was actually one of her students when she was teaching in New Orleans. She was at Dillard University before going to New York and then going to Mexico. And while she was at Dillard, she one probably the best known story of her time there was that she wanted to take her students to see a Picasso show at the New Orleans Museum of Art. But the museum was in a park, or it is in a park, that was segregated, so Black people were not allowed to go to the park. And she made an arrangement on a day when the museum was closed to have a bus drive her students directly to the museum. They got out of the bus and they didn't set foot on the grounds of the park. They went directly into the museum. and they were able to experience this art museum, many of them for the first time. What's important about that story is that Samela Lewis was one of those students, and she grew up to be not only a really important artist, but a renowned scholar of African American art, a curator, the founder of a museum of African American art in Los Angeles, and also an educator. So she is really a key figure in the history of African American art in the United States, and certainly somebody that Los Angeles should be proud of, because that's where she made her home until just last year when she passed.
Now, who was Francisco Mora?
Francisco Mora was an artist at the Taller de Gráfica Popular, who Elizabeth Catlett met very soon after her arrival in Mexico. They arranged that she would teach him English and he would teach her Spanish. I think the teaching Spanish to her was more successful. But they worked together as comrades at the Taller de Gráfica Popular. They also fell in love and were married, and together had three children, all of whom work in the arts.
In Mexico.
Yes, and so he's also an artist in his own right. Yes, they met in Mexico City at the TGP.
No, I mean the children are in Mexico.
Oh, the children, sorry. One of the children, Francisco Mora, the younger, is their eldest child. He is New York City based, and he is a musician. He's a drummer. Mm-hmm. Their second son, Juan, is currently in Mexico City, so he's Mexico based, and he's a filmmaker. Their third son, David, is a sculptor and a painter. He actually worked as Elizabeth's assistant for a while in Cuernavaca, and he is based in Germany. So it's a very, very global family.
Mm-hmm. Now, apparently she was barred from returning to the United States for quite a while. Why was that? I take it was for political reasons. And what were the ostensible political reasons?
Well, this was during the Cold War, and this actually ties to her reasons for deciding to make her home in Mexico. One of the reasons she decided to make her home in Mexico was because she had fallen in love with a member of the Taller de Gráfica Popular, and so they were married, and you know that's an important piece in this story. But another really important piece that I think we need to keep in mind is that in 1946, World War II had ended. The United States and the Soviet Union had been allies in World War II. They very quickly became enemies. The Cold War really got going. I was going to say heated up, but that's a weird phrase for a Cold War. In any case, artists and activists and intellectuals and all sorts of folks who had been active in various ways on the left, who were in any ways affiliated with any organizations that were thought to be connected to the Communist Party, came under suspicion. And Elizabeth Catlett knew that if she remained at that point in the United States, that was something that would happen to her as well. So when she was in Mexico, for a long time, she came back to the United States, not very often, because she was raising three small children and she didn't have very much money. She was an artist after all. But then in 1959, the increasingly right-leaning Mexican government, at the behest of the United States government, was rounding up leftist expatriates in Mexico City, and was also arresting people who were active in the labor movement in Mexico and in other parts of the left. Elizabeth Catlett was arrested. She was imprisoned. It was a terrifying experience for her. And after that happened, because she was married to a Mexican, she was able to get Mexican citizenship. As soon as she became a Mexican citizen, the United States State Department declared her an undesirable alien and barred her from entry to the United States. So for 10 years, she wasn't allowed to travel to the United States. And it was because of her presumed political affiliations.
But eventually she was allowed to return to the United States. Is that correct? Talk to us about the circumstances.
She was. So she had been, you know, meanwhile, she's in Mexico. She's not allowed by the government to return to the United States. She had begun teaching as the first woman professor of sculpture at Mexico's National Autonomous University in the oldest art program in Mexico, one of the oldest in the Americas. So she was teaching there, showing her work. Her students were becoming, were on their way toward being accomplished artists. She was a member of the Taller de Gráfica Popular. So she was completely immersed in making art in Mexico. Certainly her sense of Black identity was foundational, and she had a really strong sense of Mexican identity, right? She felt a really strong affinity for and solidarity with Mexican people, particularly working people, particularly working women and women who, like herself, were mothers. So she was very actively producing art that was about the lived experiences of Black people in the United States and Mexican people. And she wanted to show this work. She was occasionally sending work to the United States, but she was mostly showing during those years in Mexico. And she had a show called La Experiencia Negra, The Black Experience. And she thought, okay, I've shown my Black experience to my Mexican audience. Now I want to show my Mexican experience to a Black audience. So she was offered a show at the brand new Studio Museum in Harlem. And a number of people worked together to really push the State Department to grant her a visa so that she could travel to New York for the opening of that really important exhibition. This was the exhibition that in some ways reintroduced her to a larger audience in the United States. So she was able to travel to the US. That was in 1971. She hadn't been back for 10 years since she had become a Mexican citizen, but the State Department only allowed her to go to New York. They monitored everywhere she went, and she didn't have a completely, you know, open visa to travel to the United States. So that was the first trip. She did return subsequently for other exhibitions and to visit people because she still had friends and family and comrades in the United States. So she did come back, but until she was quite elderly, she was continually pulled aside for questioning when she crossed the border. It was never an easy border crossing for her. Ultimately, perhaps because she had become so well known, near the end of her life, the State Department said to her, oh, actually, you never renounced your U.S. citizenship. You are a U.S. citizen and a Mexican citizen. Welcome home. And it was only then that she was able to travel much more freely back and forth across the border.
Now, you suggested a moment or two ago that she identified with Mexican people in Mexico. Could you elaborate on that?
Sure. Well, her husband was Mexican. Her children were Mexican and African American. She was completely immersed in her life in Mexico. She was working very closely with the other members of the Taller de Gráfica Popular. They were doing a number of collaborative projects. They would do work in support of labor unions and literacy campaigns and all sorts of work that would support the social activism and the movements for social justice in Mexico. So because of that work and because of really the immersion that she had in life in Mexico, she increasingly saw commonalities with Mexican people and experienced those commonalities, she said, especially when thinking about motherhood and what it meant to be a mother in Mexico. And so for her, she said it wasn't that she felt any less Black, right? Identity isn't like a glass, right? You can fill it up with one identity and then there's only a teeny bit of room for another identity. This was all, you know, before intersectionality was a word. But she clearly had this sense of these sort of, you know, interlaced and mutually informing and mutually affirming aspects of her identity. And so her sense of, I would say it's really a sense of solidarity and affinity and affiliation with Mexican people, really strong empathy with Mexican people that made her feel like she wanted to address her art to a Mexican audience, to speak for Mexican people as well as for African-American people. You had asked earlier about sculpture, and one of the things that I find particularly compelling about her sculpture is that sometimes when you look at one of her figures, most of her work is figurative sculpture, Most of it represents women, although not all of it. And oftentimes when you look at these figures from different angles, they will appear to be more African American or African descended, or maybe more Mexican, or maybe there's just a kind of fluidity to their identity. It's like she didn't think of identity as something singular and fixed, but rather for her it was something much more fluid and multiple. And so I think her sculpture in this really interesting and subtle way conveys that sense of what it meant for her to really be an artist who lived across that border, who lived transnationally. And certainly, you know, for your listeners in Los Angeles, so close to the border, I know that that consciousness of what it means to live in a global world, what it means to live on a border, what it means to think and work and identify transnationally across that border is something very familiar, I think, to folks who may be listening.
Finally, Professor Emerita Herzog, author of Elizabeth Catlett, an American Artist in Mexico. Are there any websites that we can visit so we can see what her art looked like?
There's a website right now that her family has been working on, elizabethcatlett.net. There are also more and more places that I would suggest that folks go to find examples of her work, because her work is in a number of museums. And so you can go to the websites for museums like the Studio Museum in Harlem. You can also go to museums like the Art Institute of Chicago or the Metropolitan Museum of Art or the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. There's going to be a major retrospective of her work opening in about a year and a half, September 2024, at the Brooklyn Museum. So I know that they'll have lots of materials available about her. So I would say the best thing to do is to search for her. You will find, and the reason I'm hesitant about the website that is dedicated to her is that it's been being reworked. So I'm not sure when it will be live when people are listening to this show, but there are lots of really great sources about her. She is really starting to get the recognition that she so richly deserves.
Hear, hear. And I'm afraid we're going to leave it there. Professor Emerita Melanie Herzog at Edgewood College in Wisconsin, author of Elizabeth Catlett, an American Artist in Mexico. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK, Los Angeles.
Thanks so much for having me. It's really been a delight to have this conversation with you.
Ditto.
My name is Bilal Hassan Ibn Muhammad II. I'm a legally detained pretrial at the El Paso County Jail Annex. I've been fighting starvation and malnourishment for most, if not all, my stay here going on 8 years. There have been many points in time when I did not have any food whatsoever for up to 8 days. The tour requires me to consume only orthodox kosher food. State and federal law requires the jail to furnish me with such a diet, which also provides me with adequate nutrition, but the jail refuses to do so. So I'm forced to live off purchasing kosher food items from the jail weekly commissary, which there are not a lot of said items to choose from, nor do I have many, if any, healthy kosher options to choose from in that commissary. So all the items in the weekly commissary are also outrageously expensive. In comparison, you would pay only a fraction of the cost at your local grocery store or convenience store. Being so, I cannot afford commissary all the time. Even if I could, that would still not allow me to stay healthy. For example, I could spend $150 on commissary, and that may not even last 5 days. Then 2 days I would go without food till the next commissary order. Either way, whether I have commissary or not, results in me being malnourished, as my body never gets the proper amounts of essential proteins, fats, vitamins, and minerals, etc. And since this has been going on long term, my body has developed thyroid disease and many other health complications. not to mention the psychological and neurological negative effects. So there's a lot on my plate that I'm dealing with emotionally, legally, mentally, spiritually, and financially. I have been fighting this federal lawsuit against the jail since 2019. Jail Medical was giving me a small food supplementation of insurance, an 8-ounce portion 3 times a day, which helped a little in terms of nutrition and a lot in commissary expenses, but was stopped recently for no reason. At the same time, my federal lawsuit had motions which led up to its dismissal, and I believe that the jail basically cut my nutrition or the insurance to hamper my ability to prosecute those motions and the expected appeal. So all this started about or a little before I stopped giving my commissary. So the lawsuit is basically to enforce various civil rights, especially my religious and nutritional rights. The federal district court has been very hostile towards me and has all but directly said to me that I have no rights, nor do I have the right to adequate nutrition, which is contrary to law. And to put this in a little more context, the district court has already dismissed my lawsuit 2 or 3 times in the past, which I appealed to the U.S. Court of Appeals, the Fifth Circuit, and I won every time, and the suit was remanded back to the district court. I call this unjust tactic used by the district court judicial ping pong. And this is how it's played, basically. My suit gets wrongfully dismissed, and I beam the ball, and then serves to the appellate court. Then I get paddled back to the district court, and so on and so forth. Most people give up due to the delay and costs that are incurred, in the appeal. The district court has been wearing me down over the years by playing this game of ping pong. So recently, I've been way more malnourished than I normally am, and dealing with the district court and designing my appeal, all this has gotten me down a lot. You all give me hope and the strength to keep going, and I love each and every single one of you. Power to the people.
These commentaries are recorded by Prison Radio.
I haven't truly introduced myself since I've been on Prison Radio. Let me apologize for that. Hello, I'm Jodonis Jerome Olivas, a 30-year-old who's on his 14th straight year of incarceration for several attempted murders, which occurred in Los Angeles when I was 16 years old. I have no knowledge of the crime. I'm innocent, honestly. I'm no angel. I've had a dark past and troubled upbringing. I found out I had this writing gift, and now I'm stepping into my greatness. I'm writing a documentary as we speak. This prison cell has turned into a laboratory, and watch what is formed through my science. Who is Jodonis Olivas? He is one of light, peace, growth, maturity, and knowledge. I swear with each writing, I'm trying to heal the world. I put my soul into this for you who listen. I don't know this whole path before me, but I swear anything could happen. I just feel it. I pray that I inspire you to be great also, no matter where you're located, and know that there is a crown on your head. Please realize it. Yours truly, Jodonis Olivas.
These commentaries are recorded by Prison Radio.
And in closing, we'd like to thank our guests. Thank you, Dr. Moya Bailey. Thank you, Dr. Melanie Herzog. Thank you to our producers, Dr. Gerald Horne, Brother Brandon, Sister Flora, Sister Femi. Thank you to our board op, Wendell. Thank you, Matt Perez, and all those who made today's program possible. This program, as well as prior programs, can be reheard for the next 60 days. Please go to kpfk.org, audio archives, scroll to Freedom Now. And until next week, signing off, this is Sister Thage, and as always, we stand ready for revolution.